Good morning. Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning.
I had to wake everybody up this morning. All right, very good. It's good to be gathered for worship on this, the 20th Sunday after Pentecost. We gather with reassurances of God's love and grace in our lives and God's presence in this world through all things. We welcome those who are worshiping or watching via the YouTube channel or the Facebook page. Again, if you're there and want to look at the side or underneath, there's a link for the worship bulletin, so you can open that up and be able to participate in worship fully with the liturgy and the prayers and the hymns and other parts of worship this morning. A few reminders. This is a third Sunday, so after worship this morning, from 12:15 to 1 o'clock, we will have communion distribution in the parking lot for those who would like to come who haven't been able to come to our in-person worship opportunities. So that will be in the parking lot from 12:15 to 1. Again, on Tuesday at noon, we have the in-person worship for our senior adults, just a little extra layer of safety for them as they are at higher risk. So that'll be a Tuesday at noon. And then next Sunday, a very special Sunday, it's Reformation Sunday, but also the rite of confirmation for five of our brothers and sisters in Christ here at Living Springs. And so we have a unity in-person worship experience at 10 o'clock. There'll be one service next Sunday at 10 o'clock. The confirmands, family, and others will be here in the sanctuary. We invite everyone else to come and gather on the church lawn, or we may be able to use the fellowship hall if there's some overflow. And we'll have the service streamed and projected out onto the lawn so that we can all be here safely distanced, but be here as God's people together for this very special time, this rite of confirmation for our young disciples on Reformation Sunday. So that's Sunday at 10 o'clock. We will stream the service, so if you're not comfortable or able to be here, can watch at 10 o'clock from at home or wherever you may be as well. We prepare to worship this morning by receiving the good news of God's forgiveness, and we may stand. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, who creates, redeems, and sustains us and all of creation. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Faithful God, have mercy on us. We confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We turn from your loving embrace and go our own ways. We pass judgment on one another before examining ourselves. We place our own needs before those of our neighbors. We keep your gift of salvation to ourselves. Make us humble, cast away our transgressions, and turn us again to life in you, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. God does hear the cries of all who call out in need. And through his death and resurrection, Christ has made us his own. Hear the truth that God proclaims. Your sins are forgiven in the name of Jesus Christ. Led by the Holy Spirit, live in freedom and newness to do God's work in the world. Amen.
Amen.
Our worship continues in song.
Thank you.
of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
Also with you.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord.
This time we typically invite all our youth, children, young adults to come gather on the steps for a special message. So wherever you're at this morning, may move a little closer to your screen or device. And Adriana is here to share the message with us this day. As she's coming up, we'll sing our Forward in Faith song, which has been our theme for this fall.
Forward in faith, forward in faith. Christ is leading us forward in faith, forward in faith, forward in faith. With our eyes on Jesus, we're running the race.
Hi, everybody.
Good morning.
Good morning. Good morning. I'm so glad to see y'all. I have a couple of tricky questions I want to ask everybody. I want to see if y'all can come up with the answers. So if it takes 20 minutes to hard boil one egg, how long does it take to hard boil two eggs? Do we know? The answer is 20 minutes. It takes the same amount of time to do two eggs as one. Well, how about another one? A farmer has 15 sheep, and all but 9 of them die. How many sheep does he have left?
None.
Oh, that's another trick question, because he has 9. All but 9 have died. Have y'all ever tried to trick somebody? Or has someone tried to trick one of us? Yeah, maybe. It's not too fun. Well, there are some people who were trying to trick Jesus. They wanted to get him into trouble. Back in the day, Jesus lived under Roman rule, and the people who lived under the Roman Empire had to pay taxes to Caesar. Now, there were some religious leaders who wanted to get Jesus in trouble, and they wanted to ask him a tricky question. If he said yes, one group of people wouldn't be too happy, and if he said no, then another group wouldn't be very happy. So here's the tricky question they asked. Should the people be paying their taxes? What should we give to Caesar? Well, Jesus knew what they were trying to do. And he said, "Where's a coin? Can you give me a coin?" Picked up a coin. And he said, "Who is this? Who is on this coin?" And they said, "Well, it's Caesar." And Jesus said, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar's." Now, if some of us go to our piggy banks, our wallets or our purses, we can pull out a coin and I have my quarter here. And if I look at my quarter, it has a picture of George Washington, our first president of the United States of America. It's kind of like the coin with Caesar's face on it. So maybe our quarters and dimes kind of belong to George or Abraham Lincoln on our pennies. And we pay these to the United States of America in taxes. Not all of us really like that, but it's something we have to do. So what about God, though? After Jesus said, "Give to Caesar what is Caesar's," he also said, "Give to God what is God's." So what is God's? What do we give to God? What if we look in the mirror and we see ourselves? And we are all made in the image of God. So that must mean we belong to God, and we should give ourselves to God. I want everybody to fold their hands with me as we talk to God and give him our thanks and praise, okay? Dear God, thank you for loving us.
Thank you for loving us.
Help us to give you what is yours.
Help us to give you what is yours.
And to give you your praise every day.
And to give you your praise every day.
In Jesus' name we pray.
In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Amen.
The first reading. The prophet announces that Cyrus, the Persian emperor, is the one the Lord has anointed to end Israel's exile. The Lord makes this choice so that the whole world will recognize this Lord as the only God. Persia had a God of light and a God of darkness. The Lord claims sovereignty over both light and darkness. A reading from Isaiah. Thus says the Lord to the anointed, to Cyrus, whose right hand I have grasped, to subdue nations before him and strip kings of their robes, to open doors before him, and the gates shall not be closed. I will go before you and level the mountains. I will break in pieces the doors of bronze and cut through the bars of iron. I will give you the treasures of darkness and the riches hidden in secret places, so that you may know that it is I, the Lord, the God of Israel, who call you by your name for the sake of my servant Jacob and Israel my chosen. I call you by your name. I surname you, though you do not know me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. Besides me, there is no God. I am you. I arm you, though you do not know me, so that they may know from the rising of the sun and from the west that there is no one besides me. I am the Lord, and there is no other. I form light and create darkness. I make weal and create woe. I, the Lord, do all these things. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Please join me in a reading from Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth.
Sing to the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord.
Proclaim God's salvation from day to day.
Declare God's glory among the nations and God's wonders among all peoples.
For great is the Lord and greatly to be praised, more to be feared than all gods.
As for all the gods of the nations, they are but idols, but you, O Lord, have made the heavens.
Majesty and magnificence are in your presence. Power and splendor are in your sanctuary.
Ascribe to the Lord, you families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord honor and power.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor and the holy name. Bring offerings and enter the courts of the Lord.
Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. Tremble before the Lord, all the earth.
Tell it out among the nations, the Lord is King. The one who made the world so firm that it cannot be moved
will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens rejoice and let the earth be glad. Let the sea thunder and all that is in it. Let the field be joyful and all that is therein.
Then shall all the trees of the wood shout for joy at your coming, O Lord, for you come to judge the earth.
You will judge the world with righteousness,
and the peoples with your truth.
The second reading. Most likely, this letter is the first written by Paul. Paul gives pastoral encouragement and reassurances to new Christians living in an antagonistic environment. Their commitment of faith, love, and hope makes them a model for other Christian communities. A reading from 1 Thessalonians. Paul, Silvanus, and Timothy, to the Church of the Thessalonians in God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Grace to you and peace. We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before our God and Father your work of faith and labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For we know, brothers and sisters, beloved by God, that he has chosen you because of our message of the gospel came to you, and not in word only, but also in power and in the Holy Spirit and with full conviction. Just as you know what kind of persons we proved to be among you for your sake, and you became imitators of us and of the Lord. For in spite of persecution, you received the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example to all believers in Macedonia and Achaia. For the word of the Lord has sounded forth from you, not only in Macedonia and Achaia, but in every place your faith in God has become known, so that we have no need to speak about it. For the people of those regions report about us what kind of welcome we had among you, and how you turned to God from idols, to serve a living and true God, and to wait for his Son from heaven, whom he raised from the dead, Jesus, who rescues us from the wrath that is coming. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, Lord.
Then the Pharisees went and plotted to entrap Jesus in what he said. So they sent their disciples to him, along with the Herodians, saying, "Teacher, we know that you are sincere and teach the way of God in accordance with truth, and show deference to no one, for you do not regard people with partiality. Tell us then what you think. Is it lawful to pay taxes to the emperor or not?" But Jesus, aware of their malice, said, "Why are you putting me to the test, you hypocrites? Show me the coin used for the tax." And they brought him a denarius. Then he said to them, "Whose head is this, and whose title?" They answered, "The emperor's." Then he said to them, "Give therefore to the emperor the things that are the emperor's, and to God the things that are God's." When they heard this, they were amazed, and they left him and went away.
the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Let us pray. O God, your Son Jesus was challenged by the world around him, and yet he found strength in your Spirit. And so too, as we gather today, we are challenged by the world around us in many different ways. Open our hearts to the Spirit within us, that by the words of your Son Jesus, we might hear your will for us and be guided by his power, his strength, his example. Speak to us by your Spirit, through your Son, in whose name we pray. Amen. His candidacy began in the backwater regions of Galilee, far away from the seats of religious and political powers in Jerusalem and Rome. His campaign, if you will, all began with the announcement of his vision of transformation and change proclaimed to all people way back in Matthew, the 4th chapter, the 17th verse. A vision proclaiming that now was the time for all to experience a total change in their lives, because the kingdom of heaven, the empire of God, the reign of God's forgiveness and grace, compassion and mercy, justice and steadfast love had come near. Not out there somewhere in the great by and by, but here and now, come near in their lives and in the world. Here among the people who are suffering with great burdens inflicted by the other empires under which they lived. The empire of Rome and the arrogant Caesar who sought to be worshipped like a god. The empire of his puppet king, Herod, who abused his position to amass his own wealth. The empire of the religious elite, chief priests and elders and scribes and Pharisees, the moral enforcers of their day who weighed the people down with burdens of their legalism. His vision, his message, were described by the parables he told about God's kingdom, of lives being changed by that inbreaking kingdom, where seed is sown freely over all sorts of soil, where that which is lost is found, where laborers are paid the same, whether they have worked all day or just an hour in God's vineyard, where there is no seniority or ego, where first and last are indistinguishable, where the humble are exalted by God's own hand. A vision of lives changed and reshaped by the teaching of his forgiveness. 7 times 70, even forgiveness extended to one's enemies. And by his teaching of love, loving God with all our heart and soul and mind and strength, loving neighbor as ourselves. A vision of God's blessing coming into people's lives in unexpected ways to folks often overlooked or even trampled by the empires of the world. Blessed are the poor in spirit, he taught from the opening beatitudes of his famous message, Sermon on the Mount. Blessed are the meek, the merciful, the peacemaker, the pure in heart, the weeping and sorrowful, those being persecuted for the sake of goodness and justice, God's righteousness. It was a vision and message of more than just empty words. It was a vision and message made real in the miracles of hope that he worked in people's lives, a vision of healing of all sorts of illnesses and infirmities, a vision of peace amidst storms, of life arising out of death, of an abundance to feed crowds of thousands with fish and loaves that everyone assumed simply would not be enough. It was a vision of life freed from worries about tomorrow, about what one will wear or eat, of life trusting in God's care just as birds of the air, lilies of the field, of life where heavy burdens could be placed upon God's own Son and replaced with his truly life-giving yoke of grace. It was a vision marked by the very name the gospel writer Matthew employed to describe him at his birth, Emmanuel, God with us. All this gives just a glimpse of the unimaginable vision that Jesus brought to the people, a vision which Jesus, the risen and living Lord, still brings to us today. It was a vision that caught fire among the people, which inspired disciples to leave everything to follow him and to learn at the Master's feet about this kingdom of heaven, this reign of God. It was a vision that surrounded Jesus all the way from Galilee down to Jerusalem, the seat of religious and political power for the people. And sadly, but perhaps not surprisingly, it was a vision which prompted resistance and anger from the powers that be as soon as he arrived there in Jerusalem. And for days they had been plotting how to derail him. The leaders could not bear the thought of letting go of their vision of self-serving power. And so Jesus had to be stopped, they concluded, even killed if necessary. In today's gospel, we see the depth of their opposition to the reign of God's forgiveness and grace and compassion and mercy and justice and steadfast love, which Jesus embodied. For surprisingly, we have two parties who in every other circumstance were diametrically opposed to each other, despised and hated each other, the Pharisees and the Herodians. But now even their opposition to each other would be put aside as they conspired together to take down the threat of Jesus. The Herodians supported the tribute the people were required to pay to Caesar in Rome because they wanted to preserve the role of King Herod as Rome's puppet king. The Pharisees opposed the tribute paid to Caesar in Rome and the use of the Roman coinage because they believed that even the use of the coins with Caesar's image acknowledged Caesar's claim to be some type of god. And the people there in Jerusalem, well, they were divided into their camps as well. So it was a clever ploy, as the gospel suggests. These two opposing parties coming together to ask a no-win question of Jesus. Whatever answer he gave would surely split apart the base power this Galilean pretender had amassed among the people. And whatever answer he gave would surely derail his campaign and destroy his Messiah candidacy. They even began by buttering him up, did you notice? Jesus, we know you always speak the truth, that you are never swayed by the polls, that you will give us an answer no matter whom it alienates. And with such false flattery, they're doubling down and putting the pressure on. You can't dodge the question, Jesus. You've got to give us an either-or answer, Jesus. And yet they are astounded, amazed, the gospel says. Amazed by Jesus' cleverness. Amazed by his ability to see right through them and their ploy. Amazed by his refusal to bite on their either-or trap. Amazed by his both-and wisdom. At least that's their perspective, as people who could only see every situation through the lens of worldly power. Over the centuries, Jesus' famous answer has often been taken that way by human beings who too can only see and hear things through the lens of the world. Jesus' response about render unto Caesar the things that are Caesar and unto God the things that are God's has been interpreted and used for all sorts of human things. Doctrines of separation of church and state, arguments regarding tax policies, recruiting pushes for armies in times of war throughout the Middle Ages, even into modern eras. Debates about our financial giving to honor God. By the way, the question about the Roman coin and the taxation tribute was completely separate from anything to do with tithes and offerings given for the Lord with the temple coinage that did not have Caesar's image. But the list goes on and on. And yet there is such a deeper level to Jesus' answer, isn't there?
Adriana touched upon it in her message with the children earlier. The coin was imprinted with Caesar's image, which is the direction Jesus took the conversation. This concept of an image. And then he ends with a somewhat mysterious open-ended phrase that leaves his challengers standing there with their jaws dropping. And give to God the things that are God's. Say it with me. And give to God the things that are God's. So what are the things that have God's image imprinted on them? And here Scripture gives the clear answer all the way back at the beginning, Genesis, the first chapter, verse 27. So God created humankind in God's image. In the image of God, God created them. It is you and me, ourselves, as Adriana suggested earlier, it is you and me who are imprinted with God's image. It is our very selves, the totality of our lives, that Jesus says are to be given to God. Our heart, our soul, our mind, our strength, everything that we are, this is what is to be given to God. After all, it's what Jesus' vision had been about. What his mission had been about. This is the campaign Jesus had initiated so that all humanity may be given to God. It echoes the universal truth we heard from the ancient prophet Isaiah in today's Old Testament lesson. I call you by your name, the prophets spoke the word of the Lord. I am the Lord, and there is no other. It echoes the consistency of Jesus' reply to another question the Pharisees will use to try to trick him just two paragraphs later in the Gospel of Matthew after today's lesson. Teacher, which commandment of the law is the greatest? A lawyer will come up and ask him on behalf of the Pharisees. To which Jesus will reply, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. But Jesus continues, there's a second commandment like it, equal to it, he says. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. Give to God what is God's. Give to God our entire selves, created in God's image. And this giving of our entire selves to God, this giving of our hearts and souls and minds, looks not like a coin given in tribute to an earthly Caesar. But it looks like love. Active love. Complete and total self-giving agape love for our neighbors. Loving our neighbors as much as we love ourselves. Give to God what is God's, Jesus says. Amazing those leaders who have come to derail his mission regarding the kingdom of God come near. Give to God what is God's. Give to God the entirety of humanity. All humanity made in God's image. Give to God, Jesus says to those power-hungry leaders, all those whom you have been ostracizing from God with your labels and categories. Give to God what is God's, Jesus says. The tax collectors and sinners and prostitutes caught up in human trafficking, all those you leaders have been condemning me for associating with, says Jesus. Give to God what is God's, Jesus says. All those human beings who are being used by pawns in the empires of the world, all those being chewed up and ostracized from God by the burden of your religious legalism, all those being chewed up and spit out by the unjust economic systems and military threats of Caesar's self-promoting empire. Give to God what is God's, Jesus says. The poor in spirit, the meek, the grieving, the persecuted, the weeping, the hungering, and the thirsting that I have come to minister to. all those Gentiles and others who too are created in the image of God, people of all nationalities and ethnicities, people who speak different languages and worship differently and live differently, all those people on whom the Spirit of God will be poured out, as the prophet Joel foretold. Give to God what is God's, Jesus says to you and me today. All of us who have not only been created in God's image, but have been called by name and given our identity as sisters and brothers of Jesus and claimed as God's own children in those waters of baptismal grace for all. Give to God what is God's, our very hearts and souls and minds, that we might be the body, the flesh of Christ for others in a still hurting and struggling pandemic world with all its other injustices. Just as those early Christians way back in Thessalonica were being the body of Christ for others in their troubled world, as we heard Paul write to encourage them in today's second lesson. Did you hear his words for them and for us? We always give thanks to God for all of you and mention you in our prayers, constantly remembering before God your work of faith. There it is, forward in faith. Constantly remembering before God the labor of love and steadfastness of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ. For in spite of persecution, you receive the word with joy, inspired by the Holy Spirit, so that you became an example. And in every place, your faith in God has become known. How you turn to God from the world's idols to serve a living and true God, to wait for his Son from heaven, whom God raised from the dead. Oh, yes, give to God what is God's. For there is nothing, absolutely nothing, those leaders of the world's empires could do to derail the kingdom mission of Jesus and to derail his messiahship. No trick questions, no plots, no arrest, no trial, not even hanging him on a cross to die would derail his mission for us. Jesus, who would give himself completely and totally to God. Let me say that again. Jesus, who would give himself completely and totally to God on that cross, so that through his victory over death and the world's powers might be raised to set us free from those powers of this world, set us free to give ourselves to God, to give to God what is God's, to give ourselves to God with our own self-giving love for others, inspired by the Holy Spirit within us, to give our own self-giving love for our neighbors, our own self-giving love for all those around us, for all those in the world who, like each of us, are stamped and inscribed, not with the image of the world's Caesars, but with the image of God, the beautifully diverse image of God in all humanity. Give to God what is God's. Oh, yes, Jesus. You gave yourself to God for us all. And we give to God our entire selves. Our entire selves for which you came, for which you died, for which you were raised, for which you now live. You, the one who could not be derailed by the world, the Messiah, our Lord, our King, our Savior. Thanks be to God.
Confidence in God's grace and mercy, let us pray for this church, the world, and all those in need. Gracious God, you call us by name and invite us to share your good news. Send your Holy Spirit among preachers, missionaries, and evangelists. We give thanks for the witness of your servant Luke, the evangelist whom the church commemorates today. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of praise, the heavens and all creation declare your salvation. From the rising of the sun to its setting, may the whole universe show forth your goodness. Raise up devoted stewards of all that you have made. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of all, may your word of justice sound forth in every place. Restore divided nations and communities with reconciling truth. Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
God of light, we pray for those living with pain, illness, isolation, grief, anger, or doubt. Join their voices in a new song, assuring them that you call them each by name. We pray especially for Pat Bartuka,
Pat.
Gwen Brantley,
Gwen.
Carl Schmidt,
Carl.
Melody Hare,
Melody.
Elise Gerald,
Elise.
Anne Duquette,
Anne.
Lois Mattson,
Lois.
Barbara Embert,
Barbara.
Elizabeth Maddox,
Elizabeth.
Henrietta Kaiser,
Henrietta.
Debbie Smith,
Debbie.
Tammy Mancuso,
Tammy.
Ed Brennan,
Ed.
Margaret Blank,
Margaret.
Charles Kaufman,
Charles.
Beauty Talbert,
Beauty.
William Appleton,
William.
Kelly Koziel,
Kelly.
Lila Bell,
Lila.
Wilma Bracy,
Wilma.
Charles Levitt,
Charles.
The Acorn family,
Acorns.
and those we name before you now, either silently or aloud.
Those affected by storms, hurricanes of the season, fires of the west, acts of violence, disaster, injustice in the world, first responders, emergency workers.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of truth, you show no partiality. May your spirit guide the work of justices, magistrates, court officials, and all vocations of the law, that your promise of restoration may be known. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We pray for our confirmation students who are in their final week of preparation to affirm their baptism. Lauren Boss.
Lauren.
Preston Ginn.
Preston.
Anna Lee Graves.
Anna Lee.
Lena Mooney.
Lena.
And Dakota Shannon.
Dakota.
Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Living God, as you raised Jesus from the dead, so raise up those who have died in you. We give thanks for their witness, confident of your rescuing welcome for all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, as we face the ongoing uncertainties around this coronavirus, we continue to pray for our nation and the world. Protect the most vulnerable among us, those who are currently sick, in isolation, are now awaiting test results. Grant wisdom, patience, and clarity to scientists, vaccine researchers, leaders, educators, and healthcare, food, and essential workers as their daily work puts them at risk. Fill us with patience and guide us as we consider how best to continue to respond in our families, congregations, workplaces, schools, and communities. Give us courage to face these days not with fear or self-centeredness, but with compassion, concern, and acts of loving service for others, trusting that you abide with us always. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Listen as we call on you, O God, and enfold in your loving arms all for whom we pray. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
The peace of Christ be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us share a sign of peace with those around us this day.
God's peace.
We continue to give thanks to God for all the offerings of love for our Lord that are dropped off at the church, mailed here, given at the in-person worship services, or given through our Giveify app, or through other bank arrangements that families and individuals have made. So at this time, we present the offering plate representing all those offerings that continue to support the work of Christ in this place in the world. Let us pray. O God of goodness and growth, all creation is yours, and your faithfulness is as firm as the heavens. Water and word, wine and bread, these are signs of your abundant grace. Nourish us through these gifts, that we might proclaim your steadfast love in our communities and in the world, through Jesus Christ, our strength and our song.
Amen.
Again, this meal of God's grace will be distributed and available in the parking lot today, this Lord's Day, beginning at 12:15. And so now we celebrate this gift of God's love. The Lord be with you.
Also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks. broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out your spirit of love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, we pray as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Friends of Jesus, come to this table. Receive nourishment for your journey. Thanks be to God. The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace.
Amen.
Amen.
Let us receive the benediction. Neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor rulers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. God the Creator, Jesus the Christ, and the Holy Spirit the Comforter, bless you and keep you in eternal love. Amen.
Amen.
Letter of the King.
surrounded by the great cloud of witnesses, go in peace to run the race and move forward in faith.
Thanks be to God.